So first question I was asked is how difficult or easy has it been for me to make it, make my own place in a highly closed circle of sabhas, especially being an outsider of sorts. Well, I've been very fortunate that people have accepted my music, and I would like to think that it has nothing to do with who I am or where I'm from or anything like that. I will say, in the beginning, when I started performing in Chennai, it was back in my student days, when I was coming back and forth from the US where I grew up. Back then, I would say that some people didn't take me very seriously because there were many people, kind of going back and forth and learning and performing like I was. They just thought that, as NRAs, we just come here, splurge our money, and learn from the best gurus for a short period, then go back to the US and continue our education. But from that time itself, I was very serious about learning the art, studiously, and once I started performing, about performing seriously. So I was a little irked by people not taking me seriously, but I guess talent is the greatest equalizer. And once I came here and started performing regularly and things, people accepted me with open arms, and I'm very grateful for that. So the second question is, what is my advice to aspiring young musicians of the non-resident Indian diaspora? No advice in particular to the NRI diaspora or the aspiring musicians from the NRI diaspora. My general outlook on life is that parents should encourage their children to find what they're passionate about, and then pursue whatever that is with full vigor, and put in a lot of hard work in that, and eventually you'll see the fruits of your labor. Third question is, you have been trained by a number of gurus, each in a different style. In these circumstances, how do you evolve a style of your own, and who has been your biggest influence? See, like anybody else, my journey is uniquely my own. Is it ideal to learn from many gurus? Probably not, but I take a lot of pride in my journey. I was lucky to learn from all the gurus that I learned from. Evolving a style of my own, well, I don't know if I can ever say that. My style is probably just an amalgamation of whatever I've learned from all my gurus. So I completely owe it to them. I can't even say my music is my own, because it is, like I said, it's just a combination of what I have learned from my gurus, what I have been able, they have taught me so much, but whatever little I've been able to grasp from that, as well as, whatever music I've listened to on my own, and the little practice and hard work that I've put in, that is just a combination of, my music is just a combination of all of that. So it is for, people who listen to my music to say whether I have a style of my own or whatever it may be. It's for other people to judge. My three biggest influences have been my three primary gurus. Though I have learned from, many great musicians, my three primary gurus have been Srimati Padma Kutty of Irvine, California, where I grew up, Delhi Sri Sundararajan, who I have been taking training from since 2001, and Sri R.K. Sriram Kumar, who I have been under the guidance of for the past 8 to 9 years. Yeah, I'm very grateful to all my gurus for all that they have given me, and I and my music are totally a result of their tutelage. The fourth question is, do you believe that artists slash performers have a responsibility to shape and lift audience quality and sensibilities? Before I move on to the other parts of the question, I would like to say that I don't think we need to assume that we are lifting the audience, or making them, elevating them to some level. Yes, that is eventually the goal, but I don't think we need to burden ourselves with that. We should trust in the essence of our music, and pursue the music as best as we can. And I think, as a result, what will happen is, the people who listen to us will automatically get elevated, because the substance of the music that we sing is so great. So I think if we just trust in that, then automatically this elevation, and people having wonderful experiences, positive emotional experiences will happen on its own. Yes, I think it's important to respect the audience who comes to listen to us, but at the same time, there's no need to, you know, pander, you know, for lack of a better word, to their tastes, because everyone has a different taste, and when people are listening as a gathering, it's impossible to cater to every single person's taste. So we should trust in the essence of our own music, and it'll reach out on its own to everybody. The other parts of the question is, how do you get more people to come and hear a live concert than retreat to homes with CDs of concerts? Well, obviously, as we all know, there's so much content online that people can easily access to listen to. But despite that, nothing beats the experience of listening to a concert live and listening to music as it is being produced. There's just something special about the vibration that comes from that interaction. And as far as how do we get more people to come and listen to concerts, well, social media is there, obviously, so everybody, you know, uses that in a positive way to kind of reach out to more and more people, and I think it has a very positive influence. So yeah, the last question: Does branded music and musicians, social media superstars, and short and well-rehearsed concerts rob the quality and charm of Carnatic concerts one gets to hear these days? First of all, I think it's conditioning that, you know, leads us to believe that a factor even influences our listening experience. I think the success, or, you know, how we judge an experience, the great overwhelming factor is the talent and the ability of the musician or the performer himself or herself. I think that overrides all these peripheral conditions, such as, you know, time of the concert or branded music or recorded music or live music. I mean, if the musician is good and the audience deems his or her music worthwhile and worth listening to, I think that overrides everything. So, like I said in the beginning, I think talent is the greatest equalizer. Do you think there's a desperate need to regulate the quality of performance through an All India Radio kind of rating? This is an interesting question. I mean, All India Radio has been probably the only grading system for an art form that is really very subjective. There's no way you can say that this is good or bad, you know, beyond a point. Beyond this, I don't know if there's any need to regulate the, you know, performances and regulate the quality of performance. I mean, because who is to say? Everybody has their own set of likes and dislikes and biases and own conditioning. So I think, like I said, again, talent is the greatest equalizer. And once the audience at large deems a performer or a musician and his or her artistic material worth it, I think that is the greatest judge. And, you know, that will stand the test of time. So there's no need to go out of our way to, you know, regulate anything. It'll all happen organically, is what I feel. Thank you.